Thank you. Any new business to come before the board? Alderman Sapienza.
I'd like to congratulate Peter White on his morning show. He celebrated the 5th anniversary this week. Peter's built a real community that's enjoyed by many people in Manchester of all ages and areas of the city. So congratulations to Peter White, and thank you, Peter.
This hour on WMNH is sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 5 Dartmouth Drive in Auburn. They serve all your business needs, including employee benefits planning, corporate design and business administration, investments and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. Their phone number is 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
The Regency Collection, premier 55 and older independent living communities with 3 locations here in Manchester. Enjoy the lifestyle you deserve with heated underground parking, impressive amenities, 24-hour emergency maintenance, and on-site management. 1- and 2-bedroom apartment homes with heat, hot water, and cable included. Just minutes from Routes 93 and 293, shopping, dining, and entertainment, the Regency Collection is a perfect place to call home. Professionally managed by Palmer Asset Management. Visit us online at RegencyWestNH.com or call us at 603-546-7025. Welcome home to the Regency Collection. We're excited to hear from you.
Bring your kitchen to life with Queen City Cabinetry, located at 87 Elm Street in the historic Sunbeam Mall in Manchester. Open Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. They can be reached at 603-222-2007 or on the web at queencitycabinetrynh.com. Come see the possibilities. Queen City Cabinetry, another proud sponsor of WMNH.
Come on down to the Hop Knot at 1000 Elm Street, Manchester's premier craft beer and gourmet pretzel bar. Tell us more, Trudy.
We make our dough fresh every day. We make a variety of styles of pretzels and serve craft beer, cocktails, and a few bottles of wine. We do the traditional pretzel, and we have multiple flavors for that. We also do stuffed pretzels, pretzel sandwiches, free dessert pretzels, and pretzel knots.
The Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street.
You are listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, broadcasting at 95.3 megahertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA.
That day, and I could tell she was leaving, and I thought, oh, she'll be back, till she turned around and pointed at the wall and said, that picture from our honeymoon, that night in Frisco Bay, just give it away, she said, give it away, and that big four-poster king-size bed, so much love was made, just give it away. She said, just give it away. Just give it away. There ain't nothing in this house worth fighting over. Oh, and we're both tired of fighting anyway. So just give it away. I tried to move on, but I found that each woman I held just reminded me of that day. When that front door swung wide open, she flung her diamond ring, said, give it away, just give it away. And I said, now, honey, don't you even want your half of everything? She said, give it away. Just give it away. Just give it away. There ain't nothing in this house worth fighting over. Oh, and we're both tired of fighting anyway. I'm still right here where she left me, along with all the other things she don't care about anymore. Like that picture from our honeymoon, that night in Frisco Bay, she said, give it away. Well, I can't give it away. And that big four-poster king-size bed where all our love was made, she said, give it away. Well, I can't give it away. I've got a furnished house, a diamond ring, and a lonely broken heart full of love, and I can't even give it away.
Let's all be kind to each other and not call each other names. We're not nice.
Oh, hello, guys.
everybody. Welcome. Here we go. Happy Monday. It's that time again. Matt Connerton, Unleashed. And we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious, and it truly is glorious, a glorious spring day in downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, and also on Comcast 97 if you're in Manchester, as well as WMNH 95.3. Of course, you can stream it online, WMNHradio.org, and you can just go to mattconnerton.com and click Listen Live, and that'll get you there as well. And, of course, hello to all our friends at Raw Talk Online and the major podcasting platforms where we – ooh, I got to watch those plosive peas – where we post the show afterward and so on. So an exciting show planned for you here today because after we got off the air – on Friday, there was some breaking news in a story that we've been covering here on the program. But we'll get to that. We'll get to that. But so happy Monday, everybody. You can give us a call at 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. You can also text us at 617-917-4476. Tweet me at Matt Connerton. You can send an email to matt@mattconnerton.com. And, of course, you can interact and opine on the Facebook live chat on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. And please give that a like if you haven't done so already. And you can follow me on Twitter and on the Instagram and so forth, at Matt Connerton. But, and I do want to remind you, too, of course, that we are proudly sponsored by the Hop Knot. Don't go there today because Monday and Tuesday is their weekend. So they're closed, but they'll be open Wednesday through Sunday. And they do a thing on Sundays now, too, that's been really successful, the Sunday brunch. I got to get... got to get down there for one of those once they have the outdoor dining set up, which I believe is going to be soon. Lord knows we have the great weather for it. There's some, I think they're already doing it downstairs at Margarita's here in the building. But anyway, the Hop Knot, Jenny and I finally, after weeks of anticipation, we finally got the, I still am not clear. Is it a pizza pretzel or a pretzel pizza? It doesn't matter because it was beyond delicious. I mean, it wasn't just delicious. It was beyond delicious. Like, imagine the most delicious thing. It was beyond that. So, you know, it really was. It did not disappoint. But they have all kinds of pretzels, and they have craft beer, and they have wine. They do trivia night every Thursday night. And they do everything very safely there, which, of course, is one of the reasons why we're so proud and honored to have them as a sponsor. The staff is masked at all times, even out back in the kitchen. And, some of these restaurants you go into, you peek in the kitchen, not everyone's wearing a mask. But they do at the Hop Knot. They take it very, very seriously there. They don't want anyone getting sick, and among the staff and, of course, among the patrons. So that's very important. It's such a wonderful family that owns and operates it. So the Hop Knot and the Brady Sullivan right down the, well, right across the street here at 1000 Elm Street. So let's see. What should we do first? Well, let's say hello to everybody in the Facebook live chat first, and then we'll discuss the issue at hand. And actually, I have a number of things that I want to get to today, political and otherwise. But we do have another one of these terrible scandals with our friend EZG Eric Gagnon. There's some breaking news. If you've been following along on social media, you already know. But if you just listened to this show on Saturday, I'm sorry, on Friday rather, and you don't know anything, Brian Mackey's got the hashtag in the chat room there, hashtag Tabletgate. We will update you on that momentarily, but let's say hello to everybody. Brian Mackey is in the Facebook live chat. Brian, of course, all the way from Idaho. And I think I saw something. It's been a very hectic day, but I think I saw something on Brian's Facebook page about you got vaccinated today. Is that true, Brian? Scott Robinson in the chat room says, we need to get to the bottom of the EZG controversy. Yes. Or how do they say it on the BBC? Controversy? Or I can't do it. I like how they say it on the BBC. I just think it's fun. But I can't do it the way they do. How do they do it? Controversy. It's like they put the emphasis on a different syllable. Let's see.
Mike Pelopita joins us in the chat. Mike says, good afternoon, everyone. Mike, of course, from another one of our wonderful sponsors here at WMNH, Queen City Cabinetry. And they're a big supporter of all the shows here and of the station, so we're very appreciative. Brian Mackey says, yeehaw, come on, y'all, let's give it away. Yes, I opened with, and this is something I very rarely do, some old school country. I opened today with George Strait. And he does a song called Give It Away. And then I played the Red Hot Chili Peppers, and they have a song called Give It Away. Why? Well, we'll get to that. And if you know already. Stephen Philbrook says, happy Monday. Matt, there was a Matt Connerton imposter on the morning show. He's got nothing on afternoon, Matt. Afternoon, Matt, is much more sexy. Well, thank you. I appreciate that, Stefan. And I'm secure enough in my masculinity to accept that compliment from you. Stefan also says, let's talk about slow jazz and those leather pants again. Well, yes, I haven't worn the leather pants in a long time, but when I used to play in a lot of bands, I would wear the leather pants. And as for the jazz, Stefan, it's not slow jazz, it's smooth jazz. You may recall, April 1st of 2019, was the premiere of Matt Connerton's Smooth Jazz Experience. I don't have my sunglasses here. I can't put them on, but listen to that smooth jazz. It's groovy. Listen to that bass. Oh, yeah. I'm not going to do that for April 1st this year, though. I have something else planned, and it's going to blow your minds. April Fool's Day is coming right up. Oh, yeah. Listen to those drums. It's so groovy, the smooth jazz. Those smooth sounds. Let's just groove. Oh, yeah. That's nice. I mean, it's not Kenny G, but what is? I could listen to this all day. That's for you, Stefan Philbrook, by request. A little smooth jazz. All right. I really do. I did that. Longtime listeners will know. Back in... April 1st of 2019, I did... I mean, everyone knew it was a goof. It was an obvious April Fool's joke, but instead of doing my usual show, I did 2 hours of Matt Connerton's Smooth Jazz Experience. And then I had something planned for April Fool's Day of 2020 that was going to be a lot of fun, and COVID ruined it because we had a few weeks there where we weren't live in the studio. So I was having to record the show from home, and it just wouldn't have worked to do what I had in mind. So but I have come to the realization that while I wouldn't have thought it at the time, it will still be relevant. My April Fool's show idea for 2021. So you're gonna get it this year. What you would have gotten last year. It'll be a lot of fun, but it'll be very strange. But it's April Fool's Day. Let's see. Christian Lacoste is a top fan in the Facebook live chat. He says, any word on that scandal from that Eric guy? Oh, yes, we'll get to that. Yes, Christian Lacoste making his triumphant return to the morning show this morning. And I did call in. Actually, it worked out well. Jenny and I had to be up early because she had an appointment. So I woke up and Christian was on there. He hadn't been on there in a long time, and I called in. And so that actually was me, Stefan. That was not an imposter, but I do understand what you're saying. I'm not as sexy on the phone as I am in living color. Let's see. Texas Mike is in the Facebook live chat. He says it was nice to hear you on the morning show, Christian Lacoste. Yes, yes. Although, from what I understand, not everyone was necessarily happy to hear Christian Lacoste on the morning show. But we'll get back to that. Eric Street is a top fan in the Facebook live chat. Let's forget about donating an iPhone XR at this point. Well, it depends on who you want to donate it to. I wouldn't give it to EZG necessarily. Christian says, Matt, we should go out to breakfast. That would require me to get up early again. Well, let's not get carried away. I can only do that so much. Let's see. Christian posted hashtag tabletgate, hashtag justice for Brian. I like that. Oh, Brian says yes, he got his vaccine today. Was it the Johnson & Johnson or one of the other ones, Brian? We were hoping, you know, we took Jenny last week to get, I don't know why I say we, I took Jenny. Well, she was there too, so I guess it's we. We went to get Jenny vaccinated, but it was, she got the Pfizer. We were hoping it would be the Johnson & Johnson because it's one and done, but it was the Pfizer, and then she has her second appointment 28 days after that. Same time. They make it kind of easy that way. I'm going to have to wait a bit yet. They just started today in New Hampshire. They started 2A or, yeah, 2A, right? I'm in 3A. Or was it 2B? I'm confused. I just know I still have to wait. Let's see. O'Brien likes that, yeah. Christian says, I've got more. I've been brainstorming tons of hashtags. Feel free to unleash the hashtags. Oh, boy. Brian says, I can't believe you found that song from The George. That was easy. I just went on YouTube and I just typed in Give It Away. I knew there had to be something something else other than just the Chili Peppers song that would be appropriate for the show. Christian says, afternoon Matt is actually awake, LOL. That is true, Christian. And you know, because he lives with Jenny and I, he knows this firsthand. One of the key differences with me is in the afternoon I am fully conscious, whereas in the morning I'm not. Let's see. Brian says, that sounds like Zappa from Joe's Garage, that smooth jazz. Don't make me play it again. We might have to play it again. It's groovy. Our friend Brooklyn Mike, you know, he actually counted the number of times I said groovy when I did that April Fool's joke in 2019, and it was some astronomical number. I think it was in the triple digits. I may have leaned on the groovy a bit heavily. Let's see. Eric Street's asking, if Chris Plank sent me his resume. Not yet. Not yet. Still waiting. We'll see. Brian says, no, it was the Pfizer, or however you spell it. Yes, the Pfizer vaccine. Okay. So you'll go back in a few weeks, I presume? Oh, he goes back in 2 weeks. Okay. That's quick. I guess 2 to 4 weeks is optimum. Abigail Gem is in the chat room. Hello. Tom Blanchard says, I thought Christian had this wacko haircut, but it's actually very nice. Oh, that's very nice. Tom Blanchard complimenting Christian on his hair. Very, very good. Okay. Well, hello to everyone in the Facebook live chat. Let me give the numbers again, and then we'll get to the news at hand. And we'll start with Tabletgate, of course. But if you'd like to call in, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Text me at 617-917-4476. Tweet me at Matt Connerton or email me matt@mattconnerton.com. Just realized I have two Twitter tabs open, and that seems redundant. So when we last left off, I need one of those previously on Matt Connerton Unleashed. When we last left off on Friday, EZG had joined us via Skype to do his entertainment report. And by the way, he's going to be Skyping in this Friday as well. He did message me earlier. He would like to Skype in this Friday to also do his entertainment report. And You know, I was asking him about his tablet. I'm always asking him about the tablet. Now, Brian Mackey from Idaho, Brian felt badly. This was months ago. Brian felt badly because EZG had mentioned that he doesn't have a computer. And, you know, one might say there's a little bit of a history of people helping EZG with electronics because, speaking of electronics and the computer, Alexa here just turned on. Oh, I think it turned back off. Okay, good. I thought I was going to have to unplug it. Sometimes it just starts talking and then I have to unplug it. So, you know, for example, a couple of years ago, Daryl Dion and Peter White and Gonzo, I think it was Daryl who actually supplied the television. So for those of you who think that Daryl doesn't like Eric, he actually, you know, he did buy him a television, or not buy him. He donated a television to Eric. And then they all went to EZG's home. There were potatoes everywhere. And Gagnon's an Irish name, right? Or is it French? I don't know. Anyway, Irish people like potatoes. I can say that because I'm Irish. And I do like potatoes, come to think of it. Huh, I'll be damned. Anyway, I'd never given it that much thought. So Brian Mackey felt badly because EZG had mentioned he doesn't have a computer. And when EZG used to come in to do his entertainment report live at the news desk, he would have this big blue folder, the big blue binder. And Brian thought, well, you know, because Eric mentioned all he had is his phone. So Brian thought it would be nice to get Eric a tablet. It'll help him be more organized. He'll have something to do research on instead of lugging around all these papers. And the poor guy doesn't have a computer. And in the modern world, it's difficult to even function without a computer, right? You kind of got to have one, right? So so that was really nice. And what Brian did was he bought the tablet and had it shipped to Jenny and I. And then I presented it to Eric on the air. And Eric, there was all this rigmarole about, you know, he took it to Cricket Wireless and they told him it was going to be a lot of money to have it turned on or something to get internet on it. So then he called and announced that he was donating the tablet to the Miracle on Elm Street charity, which was very generous. But Eric, you know, somebody bought you a tablet. So we kind of intervened and talked him out of that. And then it was at one point there was actually good positive news. He had figured out a way that it wasn't going to cost much money to have it turned on or something. And he was actually excited about it. But, you know, things dragged on. And, you know, every time he'd call or would do his entertainment report, I would ask him, what's going on with the tablet? And he's like, oh yeah, you know, when I feel better, I'll do something about it. And then there was this weird thing about a password. He didn't have the password for it, which it's not supposed to come with a password. I don't know. Maybe he had put one on it. Maybe there's an option to do that, and then he forgot what it was. I don't know. So then Friday, during the entertainment report, again I brought up the tablet. I was like, well, what's going on with the tablet? And Eric said that, and Brian says, oh, the heartbreak to relive it all. And Eric very ominously said that he had found a permanent solution regarding the tablet that he didn't want to discuss on the air. Now, that sounded very ominous to me. If he had said that about a person, I would think that he had murdered someone, you know, saying he had found a permanent solution that he couldn't talk about on the air. I was like, what did you do? But he wasn't. He was talking about the tablet. So he never did tell us what he did. But then I come to find out, and I think Brian had messaged me first. Brian Mackey had messaged me and said that apparently EZG had given the tablet away to a friend. He just gave it away, and that's why I play those songs. But yeah, he just gave it away. And he actually posted to Brian Mackey's page, and Facebook is being a little weird with me. But it basically, yeah, so I can't see what it was now, but basically, I found it. I'm clicking it. Let's see if it, okay. So he posted to Brian's page. Hi, I really appreciated your tablet you gave me, but I really have no use for it, so I gave it to a friend who will put it to good use. Once again, thanks for my gift. And then it's like a picture. I guess it's supposed to be EZG of a guy like going, hey, you know, hey, thanks for the tablet, buddy. Thanks. Appreciate it. But I gave it away. You know, and now I don't know how expensive the... I don't know how expensive the tablet was, but and so I then shared that out, I shared that out on the Matt Connerton Unleashed page, and then Brian posted to that. He said, the devastation is worse today, total humanity boycott. Verinette March posted, a re-gift, at least he didn't give it back to you as a present, I guess. Well, no, Verinette, that would have been better. That actually would have been better. If EZG had re-gifted it back to Brian, Brian would have the tablet and he could either keep it or give it to someone else or get his money back. So I think we would have preferred that, would we not? Scott Robinson posted, wow, just wow, nice gesture, Brian Mackey, though. So anyway, yeah, so that was a bit shocking. So, but now we know what happened to the tablet. But there are still so many unanswered questions as EZG's newest scandal just engulfs the city. And, you know, this is, of course, only the latest in his many public humiliations. I mean, there was the Taco Gate scandal. We all remember the Taco Gate scandal, where he, you know, did that terrible thing to Peter White. And that went on for months and months. The entire city was engulfed in the scandal and in sour cream with Taco Gate. We all remember that. But this is, I'll tell you what, this is right up there. And this may be the undoing of his any political career that EZG might have had in the future. I mean, I was hoping he'd run for something someday. But now, the one other thing, obviously there are many unanswered questions, and we'll see, does this blow over quickly, or will this be the top item on the news every day for the next however many months? But there are many unanswered questions that we do need to get to the bottom of. You know, who did he give the tablet to? What did he tell the person he was giving the tablet to about the tablet? Did he tell that person it was a regift? Is the person he gave it to actually using it? Did he ever consider just returning it to EZG? So, I don't know. There are many, many unanswered questions that we need to get to the bottom of. Now, I'm not suggesting you should expect me to get to the bottom of them, because journalistically, my follow-through on these things is really poor. So, yeah. So anyway. But it was discussed this morning on The Morning Show, about 11 minutes in. Actually, if you want to listen to that, of course, it's up at WMNHradio.org. And then I brought it up again later when I called, and not knowing whether or not it had already been discussed or not, because I was asleep. But so we'll see. And of course, Christian Lacoste was on The Morning Show. And we know EZG is very jealous of Christian Lacoste. I think partly because he thinks Christian is angling to take over the Entertainment Report. And, of course, you know, EZG will never admit it, but I think he actually likes the bunk beds idea. I think he'd like to move in with us and have bunk beds with Christian. You know, I'm sure EZG would be willing to take the bottom and Christian could take the top, you know. Christian might have a little easier time getting up there. Come to think of it, though, I think Christian shot it down, so maybe not. But anyway, so one other thing about this that I wanted to do, though, before we leave this subject for now. Abigail Gem says, poor Easy G, only guy I know who has to relive his bad acts regularly on the radio at 7 a.m. and 5 p.m. Well, you know, I mean, we had a president who had to relive a lot of bad things every day. If I had to relive my bad acts, I'd stop listening. Well, fortunately, Abigail, you haven't, have you given away anything expensive that you've been gifted? Hopefully you wouldn't do that. But the one other thing I wanted to do is, you know, when, it went away on me. Oh, maybe I can't do this. Where did it go? I had one other thing I wanted to do about this quickly, but I may not be able to. Oh, here we go. I found it. I thought I'd lost it. When Brian Mackey purchased the tablet for Easy G, he emailed me a note that he wanted me to print out and give to Easy G with the tablet. Now, I never printed it out because we don't have a working printer in our home because we're paperless, largely, because we're very environmentally friendly, and we're trying to be very green, both in our personal lives and in our business at home, which is really kind of just another way of saying our old printer broke and I'm too cheap to buy a new one. And on the rare occasion that I need to actually print something, I go to FedEx and just print it out there. And, I didn't do that for this, but anyway, but what I did instead is I read when presenting Eric, the wonderful, very expensive tablet that Brian Mackey got for him. I mean, it was very fancy. I read the note that Brian wanted included with the wonderful, generous gift. What I'd like to do now is, just on the off chance, and again, we don't know who now has possession of the tablet. We may never know. But in the event that that individual just happens to be listening right now, I would like to read once again Brian's note, but I'll take Easy G's name out of it. Okay, so person who has the tablet now, if you happen to be listening to this show, be it live or later, this is a very special message for you regarding the tablet. Okay, here we go, and I'm gonna take out Easy G's name. So I'll say, dear random person, Eric gave the tablet to. I hope you can put this to good use. I have watched you in your role at the station for over a year and have enjoyed it always. I never dreamed you didn't have a computer after hearing you only had a phone. I thought that this might help in your show prep and ease of use for your eyes. I wish you all the best this coming year and many more, random person I gave the tablet to. Keep it real, random person I gave the tablet to. Signed, Brian Mackey. I think that's very nice. And Brian, I think you're very generous to give this that wonderful gift to Easy G, Eric Gagnon, which he was then able to give to some other person we don't even know. I think that's wonderful, and I hope that the person who now has the tablet, I hope that that person heard that and is listening, that wonderful note, and is listening to the show on that very tablet right now. I think that is my hope. I would say that was my Christmas wish, but, you know, it's March. Let's see. Scott Robinson says, as an outsider, it seems like Brian Mackey has egg on his face. Oh, no. No, Scott, I disagree. I think there's someone in this whole scenario who frankly has an entire omelet all over his face, but it's not Brian Mackey, my friend. No, it's not Brian. Brian tried to do a good thing. All Brian did was cook the eggs. Easy G's the one who decided to shove his face right in them. Oh, boy. So there you go. So who knows? Maybe we'll... I mean, look, I will make a minimum effort. When Easy G calls, I'll try to get him to tell us who he gave the tablet to. Not because, you know, I want to try to get it back or anything. I assume that ship has sailed. But I think we're all curious. And, you know, as Bobby the Brain Heenan used to say, I'm a broadcast journalist, Gorilla Monsoon. All right. There we go. So that is the continuing story of Tabletgate. This terrible scandal. Well, we will move on to some more serious political issues. Oh, Tom Blanchard says maybe he's embarrassed and just said he gave it away. Oh, Tom, you might be on to something. Is it possible that that would make sense? That would make sense. Maybe he got so frustrated, he's embarrassed that he can't figure out the tablet that he said, you know what? I'll just tell everyone I gave it away. When I actually still have it, I just can't figure out how to use it. And then if someday he does figure out how to use it, he could just say, oh, the person I gave it to gave it back to me. Is Eric Gagnon that diabolical that he would think of that, though? Scott says it's a good thing the Hulkster didn't give him the tablet. That's right. What would Easy G do when Hulkamania ran wild on him? We'll have to ask him that. We'll have to ask him. All right. Well, we'll move on. We'll move on from that for now. But let me give the numbers again. 603-250-6007. 603-250-6007. If you would like to call, you can text me at 617-917-4476. Oh, and by the way, if you contact me with information regarding Tabletgate, I promise to keep it confidential. You just have to make sure you tell me this is confidential. And, you know, feel free to call, but disguise your voice. If you have information about Tabletgate, because I do feel some obligation journalistically to make something that vaguely resembles a minimum effort to get to the bottom of all of this. I feel I owe that to the audience and to Brian Mackey. You know, by the way, speaking of which, Brian Mackey gave me this wonderful hat. For those of you watching online, you can see this wonderful hat. No More Excuses 2021, which I get compliments on. And not for nothing, but it's never occurred to me to give away the hat. But let's see. We have a call. Let's grab this. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this? Hello? Is it the Phantom? I can hear. Did someone pocket dial us?
Hello?
Hello? Who's this?
Yes, I am.
Do you have information about the tablet?
This is Al in Goffstown.
Al in Goffstown. Do you have information about the tablet, Al? All right. I've lost patience with Al, which is unfortunate because... I think Al has information he wants to share. He probably got confused and thought he was calling my private number to leave a message. And when I actually picked up, it threw him off. He's thinking, oh, my goodness. I didn't mean to, you know. Al in Goffstown, if you have, you know what, email me, matt@mattconnerton.com. And if you can include any photos of whatever evidence you have, I would appreciate it. Oh, Brian Mackey says, no more excuses. We'll be back soon. Excellent. And Dan Levasseur says, conspiracy, with two exclamation points. Let's see. We'll try this again. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
This is Al in Goffstown again. We got disconnected.
Yeah, well, the first time you called...
So I do not have any information about a tablet.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
The only tablet I have information about is the tablets I take for medication every day.
Well, that's good to have information
anyway,
about that.
If I didn't know better, and I had just turned on the radio,
mm-hmm.
I would have sworn that you were out that guy, Alex Reamer, that used to be on WGAM.
Alex Reamer, that's a familiar name, but...
you said your name like 5,276 times. So I knew you were Matt Bonner.
What about Matt Bonner? I think I know who that is. Is that a basketball player? What about him?
Yeah, I think so. I thought he was a downhill skier.
Matt Bonner? Oh, maybe. I don't know. I don't know anything about sports. What about Matt Bonner?
If I didn't know any better and I had just turned on the radio, I would have sworn that voice was the voice of Alex Reamer.
Whose voice? My voice?
Your voice, yeah.
Ah, well, I'll have to look up. Maybe I can find Alex Reamer online and see what he sounds like. So you think I sound like him?
I think he's on, I know I'm not supposed to, I've already mentioned another radio station, WGAM.
It's okay. It's okay.
He used to be on WGAM. I think he's on WEEI now.
Oh.
They fired him, I'm not sure.
Oh.
Because he called somebody a putz or something like that.
He called someone a putz? Oh, boy, tell you what, we don't...
I'm a putz, can you believe it?
Oh, I can't believe... Well, I'll tell you what, we don't work blue around here. We conduct ourselves in good taste. Alex Reamer.
You're very professional. That's why somebody's going to open up a can of whoop-ass on you.
I believe it's pronounced whoop-ass, but yes. That's very frightening. Let's see. I think I... Oh, I found... all right, let's see here. I found a clip of Alex Reamer, I think. Let's see. Talking in sports with Alex Reamer. It's going to take a moment to load, but I'm curious. See, somebody told me last week, Rob Azevedo stopped in on Friday and said, I sound like a guy named, I think it's Jim Rotolo on satellite radio. And then I went to listen to the guy and I'm like, I don't know what, Rob is hearing, but I don't think I sound like him. Okay. Here's Alex Reamer.
Yeah, here with Conversations with Rob. We have a special guest, WEEI writer extraordinaire and radio personality, Alex Reamer. Alex, thanks for coming on the program. Really appreciate it.
Okay, let's see.
Hey, Rob, anytime. Happy to do it.
All right, Alex, so let's dive.
It's hard to tell because he's on the phone there. I do think I sound a little bit like him, but maybe my inflection is similar. Yeah.
All right, when's the check coming in the mail for being the only person that's called the show?
When's the check coming in the mail? Go ahead and give us your address.
Yeah, because I'm the only person that called the show.
What, today?
Yeah.
So far?
No, yesterday.
Oh, yesterday. You called the show yesterday? You probably were the only one who called yesterday.
No, I did not. I'm being a wise guy. otherwise known as the wise rectum, because I can't say the other word.
Oh, boy. Well, you said it anyway. You can get away with that. I don't think the FCC is going to...
I slipped.
It's quite all right. Well, that's why you take that medication, so you don't slip, right?
That's it. Uh-huh. That's why I take them tablets, darn it.
Uh-huh. What kind of tablets? Are they difficult to swallow? Are they big tablets?
A metformin. Do you know what a metformin is for?
Yes, I do. I have a...
That's one.
I have a friend who just started on metformin. It's for diabetes, right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Well, you're a lot smarter than you sound there, Matthew.
What?
I said you're a lot smarter than you sound.
Oh, I'm smarter than I sound. Well, apparently I sound like Alex Reamer.
That's correct.
All right.
All right, anyway, I got to go. My supper is coming, and nobody in the world delays me on supper.
Well, hey, you know what? I can relate to that. It's my stomach's world, and you all just live in it. So, all right, Al from Goffstown, thank you for the call.
All right, then, Matthew, and take it easy.
All right, you too. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. All right, that was Al from Goffstown. He has called before, but he doesn't call very often. He calls once in a while. Al is a bit divisive, getting some not so, let's see what they're saying in the chat room. Tom Blanchard says Al lives on Gagnon Way. Charles Richardson, from Florida. And of course, the Charles Richardson Show says, who is this old geezer? What a dumbass. Oh, I like Al. He sounds like a nice guy. But I don't know. I don't know if I sound like this Alex Reamer. People tell me I sound like certain people, and then I go to listen to him. Like I said, Rob Acevedo told me I sound like Jim Rotolo, and then I go to listen to Jim Rotolo, and I'm like, I don't think I sound anything like him, but, well, you know. Miriam Banish is in the chat room. Hello, Miriam. Eric Street says Matt Bonner is from Concord. Oh, that's why I know the name. DJ Midas, who is a top fan and, of course, part of the WMNH family, host of Late Night Delight, which you can hear every Saturday night from 12 midnight to 4 a.m. with a replay on Sunday. Midas says this caller sucks. So, Midas, are you saying you like Al from Goffstown or not so much? Melanie Laliberte, I'm sure I'm still not saying that correctly, says, what the hell are these shenanigans? Well, they're shenanigans. I mean, need we say more? Shenanigans abound. Mike Pelopita seemed to suggest that the tablets Al takes might be my doll. Oh. Brian Mackey says Tom Gully is on Metformin. Oh, well, I had no idea. Well, he is from Utah. That has nothing to do with anything, but he is from Utah. Scott Robinson says, gotta eat when you can. Charles Richardson says, Al Bundy from the Slow House. And Rocky Huber joins us in the chat room. Rocky says, I need to be what Al is on. Well, apparently that would be Netformin. So, no, I have a friend of mine who just went on that, actually found out he's type 2 diabetic. Apparently, Netformin, It's Met, isn't it? Netformin sounds like someone who's in charge of maintaining the netting at a tennis match or something. Wow, that was a tortured 3.5 seconds. I apologize. But anyway, apparently metformin is an alternative to, if you don't want to necessarily go on insulin. My friend, who will remain nameless because this is all, off-air, but an off-air conversation, but he found out he's type 2 diabetic. And what his doctor told him is, we'll put you on the metformin instead of insulin, because once you're on the insulin, you have to shoot that in your arm every day and whatnot. But the metformin, I guess the idea is that will help to control things sufficiently because you can reverse, if you catch it early enough and if you do the right things, you can reverse type 2. You know, he's got to lose weight, he's got to change his eating habits, cut out the sugar, etc. But he's going to go on the metformin and do these other things and then hopefully not need to continue to take it. By the way, I'm not an MD. I'm not giving anyone medical advice or, trying to get myself in over my head. I'm just saying that's what he told me. I know nothing about these matters beyond that. Knock on wood, I've always been pretty healthy, except for my asthma, which is why I'm dodging the COVID. So there you go. Let's see. Well, the line is open, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. I wanted to talk about, maybe we should save that for the second hour. Let's do something quick. I do want to get into the situation at the border, which, CNN is covering quite a bit, by the way, regardless of what Mike Doyle says. But let's do something quick, though, that I didn't get to last week, that we can do now, and then we'll take our 5 o'clock break and then we'll come back. I wanted to get into this last week and we just didn't have time. 5 staffers have been fired from the White House for past cannabis use. I say cannabis. I don't say the M word, marijuana. Typically, I prefer to say cannabis because marijuana is the term that was invented to try to, xenophobia is a great way to sell an idea or a concept. So by making it sound foreign, when they first decided to outlaw it, our elected lawgivers and overlords at the time, they started calling it marijuana as a way of sort of demonizing it. The correct term is cannabis. And if you're a longtime listener of the show, you know that I oppose the drug war in the macro sense. I oppose the drug war entirely, but I especially oppose putting people in federal prison for possession and use of a plant, particularly a plant that does have some medicinal purposes. and uses. And I believe that while I believe the war on drugs in the broader sense needs to end, I especially want to see the prohibition of cannabis end. I think that the only reason it continues on and it prevails in the way that it does is because there are financial interests involved. You know, the big tobacco doesn't want it legal because numbers show when people are using cannabis, they're less likely to use tobacco, cigarettes and cigars and even chewing tobacco and things like that. Big pharma wants it to continue to be illegal because people who use cannabis for medicinal purposes are less likely to be taking tablets like our friend Al from Goffstown. So that cuts into their profits. The private prison lobby wants, of course, cannabis to continue to be illegal because if you were to fully legalize cannabis and if you were to let out everyone who is currently sitting, all the nonviolent drug offenders who are currently sitting in our federal prisons for cannabis, the private prison industry would suddenly find itself in a whole lot of trouble because one of the reasons, and it's another subject related, but, you know, one of the reasons why we have more incarcerated people than any other nation is because we have people in prison for cannabis use. So I don't know why the White House is firing people for admitting that they've used cannabis in the past. This is discouraging. Not only do I feel badly for the five people who were fired, but there is a larger implication here. But let's take this call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, it's Easy G.
Easy G, how are you, my friend?
Hey, I spoke to my buddy today. I was going to give the tablet to, but he said the I told him the story, and I just spoke to him earlier. Yeah, I spoke to him earlier today, and he said to just give the tablet back to Brian McKay. So on Thursday, I'm going to go to a doctor's appointment, like I told you earlier in a text, and I just have it in a bag here, a blue bag. Mm-hmm. I'm going to text. I don't know if Peter White's listening, but I'm going to text him, and I'm going to leave it on the door, and then he can pass it on to you, and you can pass it on to Brian McKay. So that way it'll be the end of the tablet scandal.
Wow. My goodness.
And then he can do what he wants with it.
Well, Easy G, let me just say, way to pull that log out of the fire.
Right. We can move on to more important news.
Wow. Can I ask you a question, though? I thought you had already given the tablet to your friend. You're saying you were going.
No, I was
going
to give. I was going to give it to this week, but he said no. He said, "Give it back to Brian McKay because he said they're making a big stink about it in this, at the studio." He said that way. He says that's a better thing to do. So.
Well, he's right. Don't you agree? That's the better thing to do.
He usually gives me good advice, so.
Yes. Well, you know what? Whoever this friend is, you should talk to him before you make all your major decisions. Or minor.
I usually do. He's been a good pal for many, many, many years.
Is your friend a life coach?
He kind of is, yeah.
Well, that's outstanding. I, you know, have your friend call in sometime. I have all kinds of things.
No, he's not a big radio guy.
I need advice on all kinds of things.
He listens a lot to the radio, but he never calls in. As Dare the Dragon Die on, he's not that kind of guy.
Right, not that kind of guy, but he's very sage. Right. He's a very wise individual.
So I'm going to text Peter White and tell him I'll be dropping the Thursday morning on the door, and
okay,
then he can give it to you, and then you can pass along to Brian McKay, whatever, how that's going to happen.
Well, very nice, EZG. Thank you so much.
We'll put an end to one scandal,
and then
won't be any more coming forward.
And then you'll be able to move on to the next one. I think that's great. Well played,
right,
sir.
Hopefully there won't be another one.
I have a feeling there will be, but EZG, well done. Well done.
All righty. So I'm going to text Peter White and let him know that I'll be coming by the studio to drop it off.
I think that's outstanding.
And leave it by the door. Then he pass it on to you, and then you can pass it on to Brian McKay.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Yes. Make sure you disinfect.
I know he's listening in the chat room. So
he is in the chat room.
Hopefully that made his day.
I'm sure that it did. I'm sure it probably made his decade.
There you go. All right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my news for the day. I'm gonna be hanging up.
And will you be Skyping in Friday?
Oh, okay. You know, when Eric. Well, now, can I just say something? I have to give myself a little bit of a pat on the back here, and I'll tell you why. People think I pick on EZG too much, but you know what? My bringing this scandal to light, I think I'm a hero. It's because of me making such a big deal about this. Now Brian Mackey's going to get his tablet back. I think I've done well here today. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, Matt, how you doing? It's Ron. Volume's kind of low, but that's okay. I can almost hear you.
Okay.
I just wanted to say, ECG, that's a great idea, but I mean, putting it on the airwaves, don't you think that's a little risky? Anybody that's listening to the radio can go by and get themselves a new tablet.
Oh, well, we don't need to necessarily put that idea into people's heads, but the thing is, Ron,
it's the first thing that came to my mind. I was like, I don't even need one, but it would make a good paperweight.
Kind of occurred to me, too. Well, and then, you know what would happen then? There would be a whole new scandal. What happened to the tablet?
Yeah, so, you know, he should have thought it through before he got on the air, but, I mean, let's just say I think the majority of the people out there are all honest, and it would never happen.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think he could have found a better way.
Well, perhaps, but you know, everything's about no contact, and with EZG, I mean, you know, we don't know where he's been, and so maybe it's best that he just leave it. But you know, he can wrap it in something, maybe. I don't know, but I'm just, Ron, don't you think though? I mean, it's really because of me that that this whole thing is being resolved. I'm a hero.
I don't even know how to comment. It's been going on for a long time. There's a lot of riffraff over it, so
it's okay.
I think a guilty conscience got him in the end.
You can say it. It won't go to my head.
If he puts it in an envelope and says, this is not the tablet for so-and-so,
that's
it
a good
should
idea.
Be safer.
That's a very good idea, Ron. I hope EZG's listening.
You think that dog at the White House was high when he bit or nipped at that guy and they got rid of him?
Well, maybe that would explain why the dog was sent back to Delaware if the dog was high, because apparently the Biden administration
might have gotten some edibles.
The Biden administration does not tolerate that, apparently.
Yeah. All right, I'll let you take a break, and I'm going to go listen to the rest of the show.
All right, Ron, thank you for the call, my friend.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye. Wow, yes. So, that's I like Ron's suggestion. What Eric should do is he should put it in an envelope and write on the envelope something like, this is not the tablet, or something like that. That way, you know, some thief or some unscrupulous individual walking by isn't tempted to grab it. Or even something more generic like, there's nothing valuable in this envelope. Something like that when he leaves the tablet. Let's see, we have another call. Busy show today. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hoo-ha!
Hoo-ah! It's Tony D. How are you, my friend?
What's up, man?
What's going on?
Trump's starting a social media platform. Read the news article this morning about it, talking about tens of millions of people joining it to wipe out Facebook,
ooh,
Instagram, and Twitter.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
what do you think of that?
I think that, honestly, the way these people are so devoted to him, the MAGA cult, I think it'll probably be successful.
Probably will.
Yeah, yeah.
And I guarantee you, like the Proud Boys and all that type of stuff is going to have its own like little group on there. And it's actually going to be damaging to him, believe it or not.
You think so?
I think it's going to be damaging because it's going to bring out all those people. It's going to bring out all those people that are, you know, the racism. It's going to bring out the cults. It's going to bring out that AQAnon or whatever, QAnon, whatever it
QAnon.
Is.
Yeah.
It's going to bring out all this stuff, and it's going to portray him for everything that's been being said over the last 3 years. It's all going to be on a platform now. You know, once you start doing stuff like that and airing your stuff out onto a platform that you're establishing because you can't get on that platform, isn't that when the truth starts to come out, Matt?
But isn't it already all out there? I mean, it's already all out there. It'll just be it'll give people a place to go and, you know.
I'm talking about for, like, people like the FBI.
Oh, okay. I get what you're saying. I'm sorry. I misunderstood where you were going. Yeah, no, that's true. Actually, yeah, you do make a good point there because apparently one of the things that the FBI is doing in terms of investigating people who participated in the insurrection on January 6th is, you know, looking at their accounts on Parler and, of course, on other social media platforms. And that's how they're, you know, they're looking at their posts and that's how they're kind of figuring out who some of these people are. And, of course, their pictures and whatnot. So, yeah, actually, you're right, Tony. I hadn't thought of that, but you're right. If all these people are, because I assume they're going to do more of these things in the future. I mean, granted, it might not be until 2024 if Trump is the Republican nominee and then he loses the election again. You know, we'll have to go through all this again. But you're right. If all these people are sort of congregating online in one space, it might make it easier for law enforcement to track these people.
I think it's going to showcase a lot of them.
Yeah.
And it's going to make it a lot easier. I mean, if I'm the director of the FBI,
mm-hmm.
I'm sitting back and I'm saying, do it. Make it easy for me.
Yeah.
You know, paint the trail.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You know, make it simple, because if you're all going to be on one, because what's been interesting is there's this other thing called Discord that's
mm-hmm.
out there.
Yep.
And they've been using Discord and for some reason, Discord hasn't shut them down. Discord has kind of been kind of allowing these group chats and video chats and stuff
mm-hmm.
like Zoom and StreamYard and all those places kind of shut it down.
Mm.
You allow a platform to be openly about the MAGA cult and all that stuff, and you're on one platform. If I'm the director of the FBI, okay,
mm-hmm.
make it easy for me, bud.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because what better place to capture threatening things than on a site
mm-hmm.
that's meant for it?
Yeah,
that's where when I read the article today, that's the first thing that popped in my head. I said he's making this extremely easy for his supporters to get in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, I hadn't thought of it that way, but you're right, Tony. That's a great point. That's a great point. Yeah.
You know, it's just you're putting us all in one place, and the FBI has to go to just one place. I mean, who was the guy that played in Ghostbusters and Honey, I Shrunk the Kids? What was his name?
Rick Moranis?
Yeah, so they posted a picture of a guy that looks like Rick Moranis on TMZ that he's on the FBI's most wanted list, and they put the picture of him when he was dressed like Darth Vader on the side because he had the same type of helmet on at the riot, and he looks just like Rick Moranis. So he might be on that website.
Right.
I don't know. That's all I was calling in for today was that, like, what your thoughts were about putting all the fish into one pond and, you know, just fishing them out once that begins.
Right, right. Yeah. There's a Gary Shandling used, I'll probably butcher it. Gary Shandling used to tell a joke about how he went fishing one time and with his friend, and this old guy who was there was like, oh, you guys should go to the other side of the pond. The fish are spawning. And Gary said, oh, great. I'll be pulling them out two at a time. That's just
I just wonder what it's going to be called.
It's much funnier when he said it, and he's dead, which sucks. But I don't know. Maybe it'll be just a Trump book.
Or oh my god,
MAGA book.
They were talking about his plane that's sitting up rotting away right now up in New York.
Oh yeah,
they were talking about it's missing parts and it hasn't been flown since his rallying days, and he was seen being flown on a little jet instead of his big Trump plane because it's missing parts and it's owed, they owe money on it. There's a lot of problems, man.
Well, I think the thing I saw that about his jet, and I think the thing is, during his presidency, it was like, well, why do we need to maintain the jet? We've got Air Force One, and we'll have it for four more years. And that didn't quite work out.
And now this thing's just rotting away.
Yeah, because from what I understand, it's going to cost... To repair one of the engines needs to be repaired, and it's going to cost just an astronomical amount of money to do it. So, yeah, it's just kind of sitting there. But He doesn't really like traveling that much anyway, from what I understand. So he's probably just going to hang out in Mar-a-Lago anyway.
Though.
Oh, of course. Of course.
He loves McDonald's.
It's amazing.
Oh, yeah, that's all I had. That's all I had for that. I thought that was interesting, putting all the fish into one pond. And it's going to be kind of funny because they're all going to go over there and they're going to have the threatening messages. And, it's sickening. They said, I don't know how long it takes, but who knows? That site could be taken down by the government,
right.
If it gets to like a threatening level. So that site could be pulled down. He could be shuttered again.
I have an idea. He should buy MySpace. It's already built, and people vaguely remember it.
That was my first. That MySpace is very near and dear to my heart.
Mm-hmm.
Tom was my first ever social media friend.
And not Tom Gulley, a different Tom. Yes.
No, not Tom Gulley.
Tom was many of our first. Do you still have a profile on MySpace, I assume, right? Because it's like impossible to get rid of a MySpace profile.
One of them's up there with one of my ex-girlfriends.
Yeah. It's not like with Facebook, if you want to delete your profile or just hide your profile or do whatever you want to your profile, you can. But with MySpace, it's like once you have a MySpace profile, it's there. Like if there's a nuclear war, the two things that will be still left are cockroaches and MySpace. It will just be eternal.
Yeah, it'll never go away.
Nope.
It'll never go. It's just like, is Napster still a thing? Like Napster and LimeWire, like is that still a thing?
I think Napster is. I think now it's just a legitimate service that you pay for, but I think Napster does still exist. I don't know if LimeWire does.
Really?
LimeWire might. I don't know. I never used it. I was always afraid to use LimeWire because, I just when I first learned about it, all these friends would tell me, "Oh yeah, you got to check out LimeWire. You can download anything from it. It's great." And I'd be like, "Oh, is it safe?" And they'd be like, "No, not at all. And you'll probably get tons of viruses and totally ruin your computer. But you got to check it out, dude. Like any song you could possibly want is right there." It's like,
there was a lot of times LimeWire where I made a lot of summer CDs.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of summer tunes or day tunes, what I was in the mood to listen to that day.
Yeah.
Good times. It reminds me of Blockbuster days.
Oh, yeah.
Blockbuster and a pizza on a Friday night.
Yeah.
That's good times. But, yeah, that's all I was calling in with. I just figured I'd toss my 2 cents in on what I thought about the social media platform and what I think it could turn into.
Yes. Well, very good. Well, exciting times ahead for the former president and social media.
Yes, the former president. Hey, how do you think Biden's been doing? You've been cool with everything?
I'm not cool with everything. I give him an A+ on pandemic. Absolute A+. However, I don't understand why the administration is firing people over past cannabis use. I definitely have some criticisms, which we'll probably get to in the second hour, about the border situation. And I'm really troubled by the lack of transparency. They don't want the media going to the border. I've got some problems there. So I'm happy about, to me, the pandemic is the absolute number one issue, just existentially. That is what I'm concerned about above all else. So on that, like I said, total A+. But I have some other concerns. I definitely have some other concerns. But I
don't like this whole gas thing. I don't like how the gas is rising.
Yeah.
I have gas being over like $3.57 by like midsummer.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, there's so many factors that go into that, and the gas prices fluctuate. I'm old enough to remember, like, when I started driving, gas was $1 a gallon, and then the first time it got, like, over $2, like, everybody was freaking out. Like, that was back during the George W. Bush administration, and everybody was freaking out, and it's like, well, it fluctuates. It goes up and down. A lot of people do blame it on Biden for shutting down Keystone, but there's a lot of different factors. But But I prefer him to Trump. Obviously, I prefer him to Trump. I mean, having an administration that's pro science, especially during a pandemic, is wonderful. There's a lot of good things. But I do have concerns. But I'm such a square peg politically. I know everyone thinks I'm like this total lefty just because of my loathing for Trump. But I'm really an independent, and I'm such a square peg politically. I don't think there is anyone who's ever going to truly make me happy as president. But I certainly prefer him to Trump. But I have some concerns. Yeah, but we'll see. It's also
early. I'm like a B minus, pushing close to the C.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. There's just some things that, you know, when he was doing his spiel, you know, when he was running, mental health is a huge thing for me.
Yeah.
He in one of his talks, you know, bringing money towards the mental health and, you know, establishing a better mental health control in the country, you know, things like this need to be addressed. And then VP Harris said the same thing, you know, mm-hmm. mental health for the ones that are, you know, suffering, the veterans and stuff like this. But like in that whole package that just went out, and it was, you know, don't get me wrong, I'm very grateful for the money that I got to help me out mm-hmm. significantly.
Yeah.
But there should have been something in that package for mental health. Should have been.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there should be in every package, there should be something towards mental health.
I think that, you know? I'm willing to give him time on that. Certainly. You know, that package was never going to be perfect because obviously there had to be some compromise. I mean, a lot of people on the hard left are not me. I'm perfectly happy with it being a completely separate issue. But a lot of people really wanted there to be a $15 minimum wage in that COVID package. Yeah. I was perfectly fine with leaving it out. Leave it out and just get it through. I really just wanted that stimulus. That was my number one thing. But I think things like mental health and whatnot, I think that will, I think that'll come.
I think mental health and just our overall health system
mm-hmm. oh,
needs
yeah.
to be readjusted.
Absolutely.
Our health system needs to be readjusted, you know, medication rates and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, these medications are expensive. You're just speaking about that diabetic medication. I can only imagine how much that costs. And even if insurance covers it.
Yeah. I don't know. I have no idea. Some medications
because
are
I'm on a blood pressure medicine.
Oh, are you?
And yeah. I've been on it. Yeah, yeah. It runs in my family. I've been on blood pressure medicine ever since I was like 21.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
It's just genetics. My great grandfather, my grandfather, my father, me, my brother, we all just runs in the family. But anyway, they wanted to change the medication to this this newer medication that just came out about a month and a half ago. Well, my insurance denied it because they don't cover it.
Yeah.
And if I wanted to pay for it, it was $457 for 90 day supply.
Oh my God.
So they had to give me something that was, I guess, equivalent, a different beta blocker, it's called, a different beta blocker that was equivalent to it at a higher dose. Because the thing is like, the higher the dose, the more things you can have wrong. Kidney stones, mm-hmm. liver damage, yada, 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 mm-hmm. third. So they wanted to give me the 5 milligrams of this, which was equivalent to the 50 milligrams of what I'm on.
Yeah.
Well, they denied it, and they wanted $457 for 90 days. Things
wow.
like that need to be changed.
Yes.
You know, things like that need to be changed because.
Definitely.
In the right world, Matt, who can afford $457 every 90 days for a medication?
Oh, yeah, that's brutal. I mean, that's.
And that's with really good insurance. That's with a union company insurance, you know,
yeah.
Independence Blue Cross Blue Shield, you know, PPO plan, and they still turn me down.
Mm hmm. Mm hmm.
You
this,
know,
yeah. There's been a little bit of progress as far as the price of medications, but not nearly enough. I mean, I remember, it's been maybe 4 or 5 years now that a lot of people have been found themselves in a situation. Speaking of, you know, we were talking earlier about diabetes or diabetes, depending on which version you have. You know, a lot of people found themselves in a situation where they were, in fact, someone I know personally. where they've been rationing their insulin because the price of insulin out of nowhere. And I think it had to do with that. They call him the Pharma Bro. I forget his name. I think he ended up in prison for fraud.
Yes, I recall the story.
But, the price of – and it didn't just go up a little bit. It's not like, you know, some people were struggling to afford it, and then all of a sudden it got a little too expensive. It went up exponentially in a very short period of time. And all of a sudden people are dying because they can't get their insulin, which used to be cheap, and all of a sudden it's absurdly expensive. And it's like – that shouldn't happen. Things like that, you know, sorry if I sound like a socialist to anyone listening who thinks that, you know, a for-profit healthcare system is just fine and dandy. But in the richest, most successful country in the history of the world, that should not happen. And there's no excuse for it.
How does Canada have it down right? We can't get on that same page. Everyone says that mm-hmm. everyone wants to look at our constitution and our democracy and everything and be a spinning image of that. But a country like Canada could have this healthcare system that's amazing for every citizen that's up there.
Yeah. Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? Like how can you not fall in that tier? If I'm not mistaken, Bernie Sanders was the one that was trying to push for something like that. Well, he was trying to push for equal health care across the system, right?
Yeah, Medicare for all, which I actually don't support that. But what I do support is a public option for people who can't get health insurance through their job or they just can't afford it.
And then being fined if you don't have it, you know,
that I never agree. That refers to the mandate in the Affordable Care Act. I actually never agreed with the mandate and I was happy to see it go away.
Either.
But I do think that that you should have, there should be a public option. No one in the richest country in the history of the world should have to go without health insurance or some sort of access to health care. No one should have to go. And by the way, in this country, even if you have, I mean, there's people who get diagnosed with cancer and then start GoFundMe pages just to pay for treatments. And it's not just the uninsured. Even people who have insurance, sometimes some of these insurance companies will find a way to deny them the treatment they need. People with cancer who have health insurance, who are fully insured, who then have to fundraise through GoFundMe campaigns just to raise the money they need because the insurance company finds some way to deny them. And that happens in the richest country on earth.
I see it every day with the dialysis patients when I go to their
home.
I see it every day.
Mm-hmm.
What the insurance company is approving for them to have for, and they do it on a weekly basis. That's why I have the job that I have.
Yeah.
Because they don't give them a month's supply. They give them a weekly supply and go by the demand. It doesn't matter what the doctor says.
Right.
I'm going there with three boxes or this other person has better. Like, I can tell you this. Someone with Medicaid, they're getting three boxes of biocarbonate to last them for the whole week compared to someone with better insurance is getting 90 boxes.
Yeah.
You know, that's the difference that I see, and I see it every day.
Mm-hmm.
Every day I see. I mean, I'm not the insurance company, but I can see what the insurance company is approving for.
Sure.
You know, and then on top of it, it's either they're having a home health aide help them, or they're having a family member who was trained, who's being paid through the state to help them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it needs to be fixed.
Yeah.
Be fixed like tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
So anyway, man, let me let you get to the top of the hour.
All right, Tony D, thank you for the call, my friend. Always a pleasure.
All right, be good.
Take care. Bye-bye. All right, our friend Tony D from Philly. Well, you know what? We are way past the top of the hour, so I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to take a very quick break. It'll be short, and then we'll come right back. A very, very busy Monday afternoon. A lot of we got some new people in the Facebook live chat, lots of great comments, and I'm sure we'll be taking more of your calls. And I have a song that I want to play. So this will be, we'll just play the one song and show some love to our great sponsors, of course, here at WMNH. And then we will be right back. This is called, this is by a Boston artist named Sean Revolta. And this is called I Should Tase You. I had to make a radio edit of this one. But it's called I Should Tase You. And this is directed at all the anti-maskers out there. So I heard this and I said, oh, I definitely have to play this on the show. It's got a cool, unique sound, too. But listen carefully to the lyrics. More Unleashed coming up. Don't go away.
Oh, hello, guys.
Welcome back, everybody. We are way into hour number two at Numero Dos of Matt Connerton Unleashed, and we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, also on Comcast 97 here in Manchester, streaming online. You can go to mattconnerton.com for all your live streaming options. And, of course, on the Facebook, on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page on this Monday, March 22, 2021. We're a little bit into spring. And, of course, here in Manchester, the weather is beautiful. I hope it's beautiful where you are. If you're not here with us, because here with us, it is warm and sunny, and it's supposed to be really nice all week. So we look forward to that. If you'd like to get in with a call, I got a little under a half hour left, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. You can also text me at 617-917-4476, tweet me at Matt Connerton, or send an email to matt@mattconnerton.com. And, of course, you can always opine and interact on the Facebook, on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. But what we would love is for you to call us so we can hear and enjoy your dulcet tones at 603-250-6007. Let's see. We have a lot of, let's do this. Let's finish off with this story and then we'll get to the Facebook Live comments and then we'll see if we can get to the other stuff. It's been a very, very busy show so far, which is a wonderful thing. I'm not going to get to everything that I wanted to get to today, after all, but I'm not complaining. It is a wonderful problem to have. I love to have a busy show with lots of interaction. So thank you all. I appreciate that. But here just quickly. So this is from BuzzFeed.com. And this story is everywhere. But I like the way BuzzFeed, I like the headline here. Five staffers were fired over past weed use, even though the White House said it'd be more chill. One cannabis advocate said, quote, just look at the fact that three of the five last presidents have admitted to past cannabis use, including Biden's former boss. So here's what it says here. Five White House staffers have been fired as a result of prior cannabis use weeks after the Biden administration said it would loosen these policies in an effort to modernize and expand the pool of people who can work there. Officials pushed back on Friday on a report from the Daily Beast that, quote, dozens of staffers have lost their jobs or been forced to work remotely due to their past weed use, saying the number was actually about a dozen. Still really bad. The officials added that there were additional security issues for some of the fired staffers, such as hard drug use. By the way, when they talk about security issues, what they typically mean is blackmail. They're worried that if someone had done something in their past, whether it be cannabis use or, in this case, as they're suggesting, hard drug use, they could be blackmailed. Ooh, give me this top secret information or I'll tell people about how I saw you do a couple lines of coke at a party. I mean, come on, you know, end the drug war, bring it all out into the open and don't worry about it. Look, I'm a musician. I can tell you in the music scene, none of these people could work anywhere with these kinds of restrictions, right? And I'm not advocating for using drugs. I don't use drugs. I've never used any hard drugs in my life, never even tried it. I'm afraid of it. It just seems like a bad idea to me. But the drug war does far more harm than good. And at the very least, we need to, you know, I forget, it's only 14 states out of 50. It's only 14 states where cannabis is now fully legal. We can't even get full legal here in New Hampshire. And we're surrounded by states and Canada where it's fully legal. I mean, we've decriminalized it, which is, you know, a big step forward. But our governor, who I did vote for, but unfortunately he won't budge on this, and I don't understand why, we can't get full legal here. But it's just ridiculous that this is an issue. And it, what concerns me about it is it shows us that maybe Joe Biden has still not evolved on this issue. I was hoping that he had. He has said in the past he thinks cannabis is a gateway drug, which I think science is, and statistics have disproven that. We have a call. We'll grab this. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, Matt. It's Mike Doyle.
Hey, Mike. How you doing?
Good. Hey, two quick things, because I know you're running late here.
Mm-hmm.
I find it amazing that, one, your point about the smoking weed and the firing people for that, if it was in their past and stuff. Don't we have some more important things right now to be worried about than maybe somebody smoked a joint at a party 5 years ago or something?
Absolutely. I think that I cannot believe, Mike, I was genuinely shocked when news of this broke. I was like, what? They're firing people for this? And what's worse is they indicated to people, this drives me nuts. They told people, be honest. Be honest on your background checks. It'll be fine. I would be hard-pressed to find anyone who is not at some point in their life at least tried cannabis. So people were honest.
Oh, sure.
People were honest. They did the right thing. And now they're getting fired? It's bizarre. It's maddening. Yeah. And I was genuinely shocked when this story broke. I was like, come on. This is awful. I think this is really terrible. Yeah. Yeah.
I was in college in 76, and you couldn't go 10 feet without smelling it, somebody running into it, doing it.
Of course.
It was everywhere.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it didn't cause the world to collapse either, you know?
Right. Absolutely.
But, hey, the other thing, real quick, on the look up tonight, if you get a chance, look up Executive Order 340B. Back in May of last year, I didn't realize this, but one out of every three Medicare patients, which is a lot, has diabetes. And,
wow, one out of three.
Trump realized that was an issue. And so what he did was last May, he signed an executive order saying to ordering the people in the government that buy the insulin to buy it in bulk. And when you buy it in bulk, you can get a discount. And
I think
if you get the discount, you pass that on to the customers that are on Medicare. And in that executive order, it capped off any Medicare patients at $35 a month. It could never go over that for a copay.
Yeah, yeah.
For insulin.
I think I remember this, Mike, and I think you and I might have even talked about it.
Happened is when Biden just came in, he put a freeze on that.
Oh, really?
He put a freeze on that program. He pretty much froze anything Trump did.
Hmm.
And one of them was this. I was reading about it about a week ago.
Yeah.
He put a freeze on that particular program. I'm going, why would you do that? You know, I don't know why you would do that.
I'll take a look
now,
at
the,
it.
The court, yeah. Look, it's called 340B.
He
signed it last May, and he was just trying to get, he was saying what you're saying. There's no reason why the biggest country in the best country in the world can't get the lowest prices like everybody else.
Yeah.
So that's when he said, start buying everything in bulk. And by doing that, we can get a discount and then pass that directly on. We don't need it.
Mm-hmm.
Pass it directly on to the consumer, which is people on Medicare.
Yeah.
So it capped it at $35, which I thought was reasonable. It's a buck a day, roughly, you know?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
A little over a buck a day to have insulin year-round.
Yep.
So, and in most cases, it realized somewhere between a 50% and 66% discount on their insulin. But for some reason, Biden put a freeze on it. So look it up tonight if you get a chance. It's kind of silly.
Yeah, but, yeah. I'll check it out.
I'm pretty sure it was, 340B.
340B. Okay. Yeah, I'll check it out, Mike. Yeah.
All right, man.
All right. Thank you for the
call. Good show as usual.
All right. Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
That's it.
All right. Bye-bye. All right, Mike Doyle. And by the way, you can occasionally hear Mike. I think he's kind of working back into the rotation. He wasn't for a while, but you can occasionally hear Mike on the morning show with Peter White, which is, of course, weekdays from 7 to 9 a.m. with a replay from 2 to 4 p.m. right before this program. But just to finish up on this story. So White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki tweeted on Friday. Well, here's her. Is this her full tweet, or is there more than one? Okay, so I'm sorry, guys. So she tweeted, of the hundreds of people hired, only five people who had started working at the White House are no longer employed as a result of this policy, unquote. Okay, well, that's nice, but that doesn't change the fact that, first of all, those five people now no longer have a job, and the policy is silly. So I'm glad it's only five people, but, you know, that's not much consolation to those five people who are now unemployed because they were honest on a background check. You know, if this was a problem, you shouldn't have hired them. Did you not get the results of the background check before bringing them on board? I mean, this is absurd. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Hey, it's EZG calling back.
Yes, EZG. Are you calling?
Hey, on a lighter note, I don't know if you heard any results from Fastlane last night.
Oh, Fastlane.
It started off pretty lousy. I'm able to follow it on my phone, the WWE Network, but that's being canceled when the Peacock takes over.
Yeah, it's already
happening. They have a watch party on WWE Network, but that's going it's going bye-bye.
Yes, Peacock is now the home of the WWE Network. And, you know, the rumor
It started out pretty lame, but they had some good matches. You know, Sheamus and what's his face there? What's his name? I can't remember his name. But
was it Drew McIntyre that he faced?
Yeah, Drew McIntyre. He always wins, that guy. I think they want to put the belt back on him. But that was a great match. It was all over the arena.
Uh-huh.
And then they had the Daniel Bryan match. He made the head of the table, Roman Reigns, tap out. But of course, there was no ref to see it.
Oh.
The ref had accidentally got thrown out of the ring. It was a pretty brutal match.
Uh-huh.
And then, of course, Edge interfered. And then he left. He beat everybody up. And then, so by the time the third referee came by, everybody was like laying in the ring. And then they said his arm was like hanging there. Because he had never tapped out before, apparently, that guy, Roman Reigns.
I believe it.
So I guess the bottom line is the rumor now is they're going to have a triple threat match.
Ah.
The Edge and the Daniel Bryan and Roman Reigns.
Well,
And then they say Daniel Bryan might, after WrestleMania, might retire.
Yeah, he might be done. All I care about, Eric, is the return of The Fiend. Apparently The Fiend returned.
Oh, yeah, I know. That was so stupid because originally the WWE never has a woman versus a man match.
Yeah, I don't like intergender matches, but I assume they did.
But she didn't do anything.
That's what I figured, yeah.
It's in her magic potion there. And
Alexa Bliss.
And then the Fiend beat up on Randy Orton.
Yeah, apparently The Fiend, he's now costume is all charred.
Roman Reigns, Fiend's going to fight Randy Orton at WrestleMania.
Yeah, they're going to have it. I read that online. They're going to have another cinematic match.
I guess all the tickets are sold out. I don't know how many they sold, but I guess it's all sold out. The ones that left are the very expensive ones.
Well, they haven't it in Florida? Because in Florida, it's like a free-for-all.
Yeah, of course, yeah. But the funny thing is Daniel Bryan, with some kind of mix-up that he was going to go to the Hall of Fame this year, and that might still happen.
You mean Dave Bautista?
Then they were saying that Bautista's not going because I think he's making a movie.
Well, also, too, I read that they want to save
Batista. Complex, so they bumped him off. Well, but he'll go back later.
I think they want to save Batista for a year where they can have a full crowd, because that's like a big deal.
Right.
Batista's a big deal.
It was funny because he was supposed to go last year because of the virus problem, and he was supposed to be the headliner.
Yes.
But now he's a big superstar now. He's a movie guy, you know?
He's a movie star. He's not on the level of The Rock.
He's making a movie right now.
I'm sure he is.
And then they released that superstar with that guy's name, A, I guess. He wanted to leave, so now he's got 90 days. He's got to wait to go somewhere else, maybe overseas or someplace.
Andrade.
And I guess he's dating Charlotte Flair. Woo!
They're engaged.
I don't know if he's dating her or what's going on.
They're engaged.
Probably just dating. And now I guess the story behind the scenes
they're engaged to be married. They're actually engaged.
But she'll get over it because she wants to get paid.
They're going to get married. They're engaged.
All right. Well, she wants to get paid, so she'll get over it.
She makes a lot of money. She does. Yeah. Yeah. She'll get over it.
She wants to fight that Raw champion there at WrestleMania.
Oh, we have a question in the chat room, Easy. It's almost like an impromptu entertainment report. Rocky Uber says, so I have a question for Easy. We all know he doesn't like the old wrestlers. What's the youngest age he thinks someone should be allowed to wrestle? Ah, good question.
The youngest age?
Yeah. What would be like the cutoff, the mandatory retirement age for a wrestler?
Nobody over 50.
So you'd cap it at 50.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They had Edge fighting on SmackDown last Friday where you were doing your lovely show there. I listened to it again.
Uh-huh.
With the Retro Special Radio, and the Edge looked horrible. He was holding his rib against the... I forget the guy he was fighting. He's fighting. I don't know no matter who he's fighting, but he looks horrible. He looks really old.
So Charlie
really won the match.
Yeah. Well,
he didn't look good at all. His stomach was all red and stuff. And I guess the WWE is not really happy with him fighting Roman Reigns. That's why they threw Daniel Bryan in the mix.
So Charles Richardson says it's about WrestleMania. It's 25,000 capacity for each night at the Raymond James Stadium in Tampa.
Right, but Vince McMahon wanted 75,000, but I guess he didn't get his way.
No. And Brian Mackey says, please tell EZG not to leave that tablet outside for anyone to take.
Oh, no, I sent him a text, and I'm going to tell him that I'm going to be putting it on the door before my appointment on Thursday there if I go get a test done.
Uh-huh.
And the... And then he'll put it aside for you, and then you can do what you have to do with it. There you go. It'll be off my hands, out of my hands. But they were saying I know you're running out of time.
Uh-huh.
They were saying that Vince McMahon's son, that Shane McMahon,
uh-huh,
time for him to not be on TV anymore.
Well, he's pushing 50, right? You probably want to see him go away.
But he had a stupid storyline now that he was injured last night. He couldn't fight Braun Strowman, so they threw in like a the guy likes to play the guitar there.
Oh,
it was like a splash match. It was like 1 minute. Oh, it's over.
Yeah.
I don't know what they're doing with Braun Strowman, but they're not giving him any good matches, that's for sure.
You know, Shane McMahon, he's involved in one of those Chinese companies.
Say that again?
Or did he step down from that? He was the CEO of something called UTV or something. UVID.
Yeah, he was gone for a long time.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. One bonus thing. Listening. I was reading a thing about AEW, and Booker T says, you know, he knows the wrestling world. He says, be careful, AEW. He says, bringing in too many old WWE farts is not doing you any good, because they said those guys can pull a muscle, they can break a leg, and they're just old.
Oh, You On Demand was the company in China. Thank you, Charles. Yes, You On Demand.
Yeah, so I don't know if Tony Khan's listening, but Booker T says, don't bring in too many of those old-timers from WWE, like WCW did.
I have it on good authority that Tony Khan listens to my show every day and takes notes, and he loves your Amanda McCarthy tour dates.
Well, there you go. But it's right, though. AEW is bringing too many of those old-timers. Those guys can only bring it. you know, they're not good no more.
You might want to respond to this, Eric. Rocky Huber says, wow, I like Easy G, but someone needs to teach him how to sound grateful regarding the tablet.
Oh, yeah, I told him on the Facebook message there. I was very grateful for it, but it didn't work out. So my buddy says, yeah, instead of me taking it, he says, just give it back to Brian McKay, and then that'll be end of the story.
Yes, yes.
He really gives me good advice, so I just called him up a few minutes ago. He said, yep, Eric, he said, great move, and then and that was it.
Well, good, good.
We all need somebody to ask important questions, you know.
Yes, yes.
It's always good to have that kind of person in your life.
Oh, it is. Yes, you should.
All right, I'll let you go. I know you're running against the end of the show. So,
all right, Eric.
That's it for me.
All right, thank you. Bye bye. All right, Easy G leaves.
Hello, guys.
Oh no, that was not easy. All right, Easy G leaves us. Yes, very nice. Rocky Huber says, you know what, Brian Mackey? I'm grateful. Thank you for the tablet you gave my friend. Very nice. Very nice. No, Easy G claims he was grateful. All right. Well, that does open up a line for you if you'd like to get in with a call. A busy show today. 603-250-6007. We do have a few minutes left. 603-250-6007. I see Pat Mills is in the Facebook live chat. Hello. Let's see. So, just to finish up on this story here. So, again, and this is from BuzzFeed. The White House is not... Oh, let me read you the full tweet from Jen Psaki about this. She tweeted, as a result, more people will serve who would not have in the past with the same level of recent drug use. The bottom line is this. Of the hundreds of people hired, only 5 people who had started working at the White House are no longer employed as a result of this policy. The White House has not published any official guidance on the new policy, but in an NBC article from last month, an official said that past cannabis use would not automatically disqualify staffers. Normally, White House staffers must receive top secret security clearance for which drug use can be disqualifying. And again, like I said, it's that whole blackmail thing. To get around this, staffers who have used cannabis only on a limited basis and whose jobs don't require the security clearance would be given a waiver to work without the clearance. Well, again, like Mike Doyle and I were talking, everybody has at some point used it, at least tried it, right? Forget the waiver, just change the policy. So it says the policy does not actually allow staffers to use cannabis or even to have previously used it more than once or twice a year? This is so archaic. According to the Associated Press, quote, limited use of marijuana means fewer than 15 times in the past year. Staffers with clearance waivers face additional rules and scrutiny, officials said. They must take a pledge to stop. What year are we in? They must take a pledge to stop using cannabis completely while working for the government, agree to random drug testing, and may be directed to work from home until they meet clearance standards. What year are we in? Though the Biden administration has been more permissive than previous presidential administrations, the terminations have faced widespread criticism, particularly because cannabis has been legal in D.C. for over 5 years. It remains illegal at the federal level. Many local and national advocates for legalization are denouncing the White House's actions. And the story goes on from there. We don't have time to get through the whole thing. But again, it's just so absurd. And there are larger implications that trouble me because, you know, Biden did signal during the campaign that he seemed to be open to a potential federal decriminalization or even legalization. Maybe. I mean, he didn't talk a lot about it. Even Trump had said that at one point, that he'd be open to it. But of course, with Trump, you know, you can't really necessarily believe anything. This is really troubling to me. We're not going to get to any of the other stuff. Again, I'm not complaining. I love a busy show. So it's a good problem to have when we can't get to everything. But tomorrow is another day, and there will be another show. I do want to try to get some more of these Facebook chat comments, so before we go, or at least make sure we acknowledge everyone in here. Let's see, because I do love to see a busy chat room. Tom Blanchard mentioned Biden canceled another pipeline. I'm not aware of that, but I'll certainly check it out. Brian Mackey says mental health will fall through the cracks like it has forever. Biden won't make it reality. Well, we'll see. We'll see. I mean, it's early. It's early yet. He has talked about the need for more focus on that. So I'm willing to give him some time there. But you're right. Mental health is always one of those things that falls through the cracks over and over again. Alex Whiteley from the UK joins us. He says NHS all the way, baby. Talking about healthcare, referring to the National Health Service that they have in the UK, which people seem to be pretty happy with, just like people are happy with the Canadian system for the most part. Let's see. Scott Robinson says, I'm surprised you could even take a break with all the controversy. Rocky Huber says, speaking of hard drugs, what do you think his son Hunter Biden's clearance is? I don't think Hunter Biden will ever have any sort of security clearance, Rocky. I think we can all assume that. let's see. Christian Lacoste says Eric is calling in with all the scandals he's in. Well, you know, he did. I mean, EZG, he made a lot of progress on Tabletgate today. Got to give him credit. Got to give me credit. I'm the one who, without me, shedding my journalistic light on it. I don't know if or shining my journalistic light. No, I guess you can shed a light on something. I don't know. Brian is happy that I'm here to handle all the drama. Let's see. And there was somebody else in here. I just want to make sure that we acknowledge. Oh, I forgot about the magazines. Rocky mentioned the magazines. Rocky says, what I find funny, Matt, is they are being told to work from home. So maybe it's so they can smoke more marijuana cigarettes. Alex Whiteley said, I mean, I get it if you're going into work wasted, but drug tests, that's ridiculous. Yeah, it's so arcane. Hey, by the way, just quickly before we run out of time, I used to work for Strawberries, you know, which was it's gone now, but it was a national record store chain. And there was a point where we actually had drug testing at Strawberries. And, you know, you're drug testing people who work in a record store. And it's very expensive to drug test people. And the company, you know, because of the internet, the company wasn't making as much money as it used to. So the drug testing did eventually go away. But it was like, really, you're, and it was because, you know, people were handling money. So it's like, oh, you got to drug test people because they're handling money every day. What if they get strung out and they need money to buy drugs? And it's like, come on, it's a music store, please. All right, we are out of time. Thank you all so much. A very busy show today. Always a great way to start the week with a nice busy show. I will be back tomorrow. Matt Connerton, Unleashed. If you miss any part of today's show, it'll be up in just a little bit. We'll have it up at the WMNH website and at mattconnerton.com. And that is it for me for now, my friends. Thank you all. And I'll talk at y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.